quick introductions and sort of understand.
What's your objective? Why did you come? Why did you select performance management? So, Donna, would you mind going first? We can.
Sure. Donna Canestrero. I'm with the Center for Technology and Government at the University of Albany. I'm interested in performance metrics and seeing how it's being applied across the state.
I'm Michelle Richens from Garnet River. I'm also interested in performance metrics, how they're being applied across the state, and how we can help our clients in New York State agencies meet those performance metrics.
I'm Dave Wehner. I represent HP, and same thing, here to learn a little more about metrics in New York State.
Great, thank you.
I'm Rick Murray with HP. I'm here to learn and observe. We have some tools that can help in this area and trying to understand more about what the requirements are and maybe identify where we can match those tools to those requirements.
Thank you.
I'm Deborah Buck. I'm with the New York State Forum. I'd like to learn about and then discuss not necessarily how they are being used in New York, but how they could be used and effectively and to assure accuracy and good information.
Okay, great, thank you.
Hi, I'm Prasanna Daptadar. I'm with CIOFT. I work in QA, and just recently, since last year, we are more and more encouraged to, put a statistics of, how much testing we do, how much tools we use. We use HP tools, how much, is the usage all over the year. So I think my senior management wants to, use that statistics to take it to the upper management and take it to the upper level to get more tools, maybe more, more staffing, more tools. So I just want to know, how the hierarchically the statistics works, I report it to my manager and my management report it to upstairs and how that works and how the upper management makes decisions.
Great, thanks very much.
Hi, Tatiana Krenov with the Office of State Comptroller. I just think that it's an interesting topic and sometimes can be challenging in government.
Very. Thanks.
Chris Messina, I'm a Java developer at DEC. I was actually just kind of more curious about what you mean by performance management.
Okay.
Whether we mean like web servers, web applications, databases, the actual employees, the agency itself. And also I was curious about the transparency really part of your thing because I want to see how transparency ties into this.
Okay.
My name is Kelly Smith-Ballas. I am with New York State Department of Motor Vehicles. My agency got involved a little bit in the former administration and potentially this administration in terms of putting up forth our metrics. So I just want to get a general sense of where people are with the technology and listen.
Well, we can't all listen.
I want to add just one more
objection. Yeah.
What I have seen is not everybody in the organization is always interested in keeping these statistics or metrics, and they find it boring. And so what's the best way to motivate them or tell them to why it is necessary in the long run?
I'm glad you put that up. For people who just came in, you have the opportunity, if you'd like, to say what are your objectives, why did you pick this one, and we could see if we can cover some of those topics.
I'd like to see how people are using metrics to motivate constituents, to motivate users to come use more. As an advertiser, look how good this is.
How to promote, if I may.
Yes, thank you.
Yep, great, thanks. Yes?
I was just wondering what tools that are out there people are using. Whether it's like the Google Analytics or the Clouts or the Whats of the world.
Great. Okay.
I have another one. Just in terms of like the metrics, making sure that you get the right metrics. Because you can have a lot of data, but it can be,
I'll refrain.
We call that making sure your ladder is leaning against the right wall before you start to climb, because otherwise you get to the top of the ladder and you know, didn't really get where you wanted to go. Okay, that's great. Let's sort of divvy up our time then and talk a little bit about use, a little bit about tools, and a little bit about what are these measures, you know? Just so you understand, my name is Doug Lapham. I worked for a company called Celeron Consulting, which is a global firm that did operational performance. So we went to chemical plants, or oil refineries, and basically put in place management, control, and reporting systems. And it was really very simple. You'd go into this asset. You know, we spent $1 billion and we built an oil refinery. Excuse me, sir. Now we need to get an ROI. We need to find out whether or not that refinery that we built to process 1,000 barrels of oil a day, let's say, is actually doing that, right? Is it actually doing 800 barrels a day, or does it vary between 800 and 900? I mean, at the end of the day, I could summarize all that performance management work we did as getting people focused on volumes, velocities, and variation, right? Because that really covers your quality piece. So how many, and sometimes these metrics are really, what are you going to count? And people would say, oh, we don't have the system, we don't have the tools. And I would pull out a pencil and a post-it note and say, over your eight-hour shift, I want you to track how many units come off the line. You know, either in six-packs or in cases or in pallets or whatever the measure is, what are you measuring? You know, what is it that in it would often lead to, well, I don't know what we measure. Do we measure quality or do we measure at the halfway point? And we usually try to push it as close to the customer possible. What are you shipping? What are you going to put on the back of the truck to go to the customer? What's that product, the software, the code, the number of help desk calls? I mean, help desks and call centers get almost grossly over-measured because you can track all kinds of stuff with the new phone systems and things like that.
Don't you have to, though, correlate that measure against the cost measurement?
You do. Okay. You do. But the question is, if you choose to measure length of call, right, or number of calls per hour,
right,
it may not correlate to customer satisfaction, right? Because
right?
Really, if it's my job to get you off the phone in 45 seconds and punch you to the next person, whereas in a minute and 5 seconds I could have solved your problem,
right.
And it really, that comes down to, are we using the right metrics, you know? And again, I like the piece that was added here are, the right metrics are different. If you go and try to tell an agency, I don't like podiums. I didn't mean to run the meeting this way. I want it to be much more interactive. So please interrupt, right? Ask good questions as we go through. If your goal is to reduce the spend of your agency by 10%, are you going to just cascade that down the organization? Are you going to make the grade 18 responsible for cutting his cost by 10%? No, you can't. Right? There's no correlation. It doesn't make sense to them. They don't own that. There's very little in their sphere of control. So you need to find a way to take metrics and say, okay, if we're going to reduce costs by 10%, right? So our volume, right, our dollars that we spend each year needs to come down by 10%. How are we going to do that? Right? It may be increased efficiency at the call center. Increased efficiency means that the calls become shorter. Right, we could put some tools in place to do that. So the velocity, the cycle time of those calls starts to shrink down as you go through there, right? But you could take that number, that velocity number, or that customer satisfaction number, and you can make it real to the individual contributor, right? The clearest example I can give of this is that one of the most effective conversations I had about this was with a mechanic who changed brakes on the tractor trailers. You know, those big container ships and the shipyards. I spent 8 months working in one of those, and this guy's job was to fix the brakes on these trailers. Like, I would shoot myself. It just sounded like the worst job in the world. He loved it, right? And nobody had ever gone to him and asked him, what frustrates you? Where's the friction in your job? What prevents you from doing your best work? And the answer was, you know, the bolts are over there, the brake pads are over there, and then the other piece that I need is over on this side of the room. And they all come from the same vendor. So we negotiated with the vendor to box all the parts that were needed for a brake job. So this mechanic had to go over and he had to pick up 8 boxes, and then he would come over and he would do 8 brake jobs in a row. And all of a sudden, instead of doing 18 per day, he was doing 30 or 32. And he was going home to his wife and he was saying, I did 32 brake jobs today. I mean, he was able to demonstrate, because he had a metric that meant something to him, that he was doing a better job. He was proud. He was more engaged in his work. He was a better employee. Okay? Now, we didn't tell the vice president of the shipping trade lane in Alaska that his guy was doing more brake pads. We did eventually, anecdotally. We told him that his costs had dropped significantly because the productivity of his employee had gone up, right? The cost, the waste, the scrap of the parts that got lost when this mechanic had to walk around this maintenance bay had gone down. So overall, he was seeing a 15% savings in the maintenance bay. And then we did the same thing with customer service, we did the same thing with the cranes, we did the same thing. So we had to find out how do we take a key number, like a goal of 10%, right? A goal that a lot of people can get into, and then break it down into reasonable parts. Now, think about it from the state point of view, right? Because the taxpayer wants to know that you're doing things more effectively, but they also want to know that they're getting the services from the government that they want to get, right? So again, you need to figure out what are the goals. Start with why, and then come up with the numbers. Too often people start with a 10% reduction. What does that mean? What context should I take that in? Did it go up 10% last year, or we're just coming down to level? Has it gone up 10% over the last 5? You know, you need to put all these things into context, and you need to understand your different audiences. So the different audiences are yourself, right? You're the ultimate consumer. You have a job, right? And you have a goal, and you may be able to allocate those tasks down. You have a supervisor at some level. You have stakeholders, right? Peers, clients, vendors. But also you have citizens. You know, your job for the state exists so that you can provide some service that makes the government more effective, more efficient, right? Better able to serve. If not, if you don't, you know, we've got some citizens.
Not necessarily just the government more efficient, but in some cases it is the mission just to serve the citizens.
Yes.
And to do that in a quality manner.
Correct.
So it's, you know, not necessarily always driven by the numbers, but it is, you know, what's the change that occurs for that customer?
Right.
Are they getting access to the right services? Are there, you know?
Yep. Yep. We did this once at the Procurements and Grants Office for the Center for Disease Control and Prevention in Atlanta. And they had a problem because they had to distribute $15 billion worth of grants around smoking cessation or substance abuse or autism awareness. You pick it. People could apply for grants. Those grants would have to go through a review cycle, and then they would have to get dispensed, right? Or it's the next fiscal year. Well, it was taking them about 340 days to distribute a grant. Okay, you see what happened? If that were to get larger, like to 366 days, there would be no grants that fiscal year. So we had to come in and we had to look at the overall process, okay, which is what we did. We actually drew out the process in a way that looked like a leaky pipe. So grants came in, the grant application would come in, it would go through this big, long process over here, and then the grant would be approved. Well, what does this have to do with performance management? Well, this is a process, right? And a certain volume of materials or grant applications went in, right? The duration of the process was the velocity, right? And then what we drew as sort of the leaky pipe was that here, right, so the long story is, first we started to measure this, and what we found is that the number of grants that were approved over here that were right the first time was 4%. 96 out of 100 grant applications were sent back to the beginning of the process, which made rework, right? Which sometimes we didn't even know why it was sent back, it was just kicked back. But oftentimes it was they didn't have the right template, they didn't have the right signature, they didn't have the right supporting documents, you know, and there were things in here where we went through this whole thing and figured out where was the material sort of dropping out of this process. So now we were able to do what at the time was called a Pareto diagram. Because if you really want to get into, you mind if I go back and give you just a little bit of background? Okay. The way I look at this is that you need some KPQs up here. You need some key performance questions. Right? What do you need to ask? What are you asked by your supervisor or by your stakeholders? Okay? Because they want to know that you're using the right stuff. And then down here, there's something called performance measurement. Performance measurement is not performance management. Right? Performance measurement is we're going to collect, we're going to process or transform, and then we're going to report. That's performance measurement. Question?
Shouldn't the next level be that the measurement is used?
Well, that leads to a decision. Right? This data is used to change something, to tighten a process, to take the friction out, to say whether or not we could do more, or whether we could do it with fewer errors, or whether we could do it with fewer people, or whether we need more people because the demand for the service is going up. This data allows you to make a decision which is going to drive you to ask different questions about your performance. And a lot of people that I've worked with have really been focused on what is performance measurement. And I'll be frank with you, a lot of people have created data landfills where they collect everything and do nothing with it. It's not coming back up here. It's not being used in a performance management frame of mind to lead better decisions. And even if it's not a better decision, the decision could be, what do I report to my boss? Right? Or what are we going to bring to the budget commission hearing? Right? Or what are we going to put in our annual report? Or what statistics go on the scorecard we put on our website? The decision could simply be, what part of this information, because you've got reams of information, do you want to share with the public? Because here's what happens. If you don't use this performance management mindset to tell the story that you want to tell, they're going to grab bits and pieces of this data. They're going to grab the unclear stuff, and they're going to make up the story that fits their reality. And most often, that's not complimentary to you. And again, this comes all the way down to the level of, I'm a call center clerk, right? And if I can't tell my boss that Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, I solve some really complex problems for people with significant English as a second language issues. So the time it took me to solve those calls was significantly longer than the goal he'd set for me, right? So the goal here isn't that performance management would be used like a stick by the supervisor to come down and say, how come you only answered 12 calls in 4 days? But rather that it could be used by the employee, by the individual contributor, to report up to his boss and say, I'm seeing an increase in English as a second language calls. Or the complexity of the problems that I have to solve in the call center have been expanding since we released the new product. I wonder if there's something in the new product or the new UI on our top box or something that's causing a difference, right? So now the individual contributor can use this formula to start making recommendations, to start using data to talk about what's wrong in their workload, what's creating friction, what's preventing them from doing their best job. What's preventing them from going home at the end of the day and saying, I did a good job today, right? Because now they can go to their boss and say, geez, you know, this happened 10 times, and in 6 out of those 10, this same problem recurred. Do you think that it's worth looking at maybe if we could fix that, right? And that's a whole process reengineering. We could talk about that as a separate thing, but this is really just about performance management. How do you put your finger on the few variables that you can use to change the equation? Yes?
So you, I'll say, disparage the data landfills that are being made by people doing performance measurements without having a decision goal at the end, but I would argue you need to have the data before there's a problem, so you have something to analyze, so you can go back and say, well, look, this changed,
mm-hmm.
or what have you. So having that landfill is probably not the right word, having this database
sure.
of performance measurements so
right.
that the, so that you can say, you know, if you start measuring when there's a problem, then you may never see or change. Or
let me, and I don't mean to be disparaging about anything. I love that people collect data. And some people say, I can't start changing until I start collecting data. And I can't start collecting data until I have the system in place or this new... You can collect data with a number two pencil and a spiral notebook. Okay. Has everybody heard this phrase, if you measure it, you can move it? Right? If you measure what you move type thing. Well, it's really an oversimplification. You know that whole keep it simple, stupid type thing? This isn't a direct correlation. If you measure it, you can report on it. And if you can report on it to the right people when you report up the organization, they will pay attention. This is the key to the realm in the Web 2.0 age. Right? This is the real currency that IT has. If you can get the attention of senior executives with a statistic, a number, a metric that tells a story, and especially one that shows a pattern over time, you know what these senior executives are going to do? They're going to change something. And when they change things, it's going to move. It's going to go up or it's going to go down. Now, the goal is to change like one or two things at a time, just good engineering practice. Not let's overhaul the whole thing. Which too often people do. But that's really what happens, is when you measure it, you can report it. And you need to choose carefully, back to what metrics do you choose, because that's going to be what people pay attention to. And if you show them a beautiful 36-page bound, slick brochure with 120 metrics in it, you've lost. Right? Right? And that's not going to get you the change you want. But if you can narrow that down to the 4 to 12 KPIs that are going to influence that audience that you're looking for, they'll make changes. And that will lead to the movement that we're talking about. And you know what? This reporting or this measurement could be pre-existing. I mean, that's where the pattern, you get to look back and see what's happened over time as you go through. So I was being a bit glib, and I apologize. I don't mean to disparage anything. Deborah, did you have...
I do, because I'm, and to kind of apply it to where I am,
mm-hmm.
here, we got a lot of data, but
yep.
it's just beans. And so we do a lot of education, and I'm changing the evaluations of events to get qualitative data, because part of our intent in terms of training people is to say that that training is relevant not only to the state, but to their jobs, helps them in their job. So it's a good change of asking questions about relevance. What's their takeaway? What are they going to do different the next day?
Right.
Those questions are voluntary, which brings me to my question. It's like, because sometimes when you get people do evaluations after an event, what they complain about is it's hot, too hot, too cold, where's my coffee?
Right.
As opposed to maybe filling out those necessary questions, because if you don't get a good number responding and you get a small random percentage, it could be the wrong responses that could drive you to wrong decisions, because it could be an event and people are saying, you missed the target on this,
right.
and the other people who really liked it walked away and said it was great, but didn't fill out that form.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
so how do you manage human dynamics to get their buy-in?
Sure, sure.
To
okay,
play?
So a specific example is that in the last few months I've been working with the local, the Upstate New York Project Management Institute chapter, the local chapter. I worked with the board on the strategic plan. And they said, we put out a survey and we had about 60 people respond out of 400 members. Oh, okay, it's not great, but it's good. And I said, about how many people come to your annual monthly dinner? About 50 to 60. And I said, wait a minute, do you think it's the same 50 or 60 that took the survey? Because maybe, you know, they're making decisions based on a false sample size, right? They're only getting the active people involved. So the decision was, we need to change our collection mechanism. Right, and so the 14 members of the board were going to pick up the phone and make random calls into the 400 people to find out whether they came or not. If they did come, was it valuable? Were they getting what they wanted to? There's a lot of really interesting stuff there. So they're going to come up with a short not a 36 question survey, a 3 to 6 question survey. Okay. Now, I don't know if you're the Psychology Today magazine put on their cover in the 60s, I think it was 1968, The Power of Seven, right? Because the thing is that people pay attention to or can really manage cognitively seven things plus or minus two. So that's the rule. If you start to ask them 10, 12, 13 questions, you're going to lose them. It's too much. If you ask them fewer than five, they won't feel like you've actually respected, you know, collecting information from them. But if you can find that seven plus or minus two, if you can get the number of metrics that you're tracking to seven plus or minus two, that'll be great. Right? And the other key thing here is, I'm going to keep drawing up here. Does anybody mind if I keep drawing?
Go ahead.
Is that the metrics change significantly depending on where you are in the organization. So if you're the CXO, right, the CIO, the CEO, the Chief Operating Officer, you're going to have a different set of needs than the directors, than the managers, than the supervisors, than the individuals. Remember, the work happens at the bottom of this pyramid, right? These are the people that are going to help you get some 10% goal, but only if you get their attention. Right? So let's shift it a little bit here. How are people using metrics now in your organization, in a development environment or a call center environment, to inform what people do? Anybody have an example? I'm trying to shut myself up here. Just take advantage of this opportunity.
We have a couple of different things. We put up monthly statistics. The agency has a variety. We also have to report not only what was our baseline last year, current performance.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't meet the target, why?
Right.
Was there
right.
variation to be understood? From an agency-wide, we maintain one of my areas of responsibility is our project management office.
Okay.
We maintain a dashboard of all of our projects. How are
right.
they doing? What are they doing? And the entire agency has access to status reports, scope, charters, business rules, and everything that's happened.
So let me ask the you to continue on that. How do you take those key performance indicators, those metrics, down to the individual? How do you go and coach either a high-performing or an underperforming individual with those numbers?
We make them available. And in terms of the individual team, say they notice that they're reporting bad stuff.
Anomaly, yeah.
It's that peer pressure of, I don't want my schedule to slip. I want to stay within target.
Mm-hmm.
There's that public,
Sure. It's a public accountability,
mm-hmm.
right? Because really, yes. Thank you. Thank you very much. Other examples of how people are using metrics?
I just want to follow up because this is really interesting on the public and what you just said about dashboards.
Mm-hmm.
Very relevant to this conference too. The federal IT dashboard came out last year or whatever.
Yeah.
And it's a big deal. Lots of government entities are looking at it and looking at using it. And I just wondered if you could comment on this, either one of you. Are dashboards useful as graphic presentations of data, and in this case, performance data?
Mm-hmm.
And two, do you wreck it when it's public, as in the general public gets to see it? Which I wonder about, because if you look at the federal IT dashboard, which has every federal agency graded across pretty reasonable criteria, on a green, yellow, and red criteria, and there must be, let's say 100 dots, bubbles.
Right.
There's like 95 green in
mm-hmm.
it. So you kind of wonder, wow, are they that good, or is this, BS? And
yeah.
So, and that question of the public facing is, one, do dashboards work internally, and do most people think that they work, they honestly do work, or can they measure them working?
Yep.
And two, does public facing accountability in a public facing dashboard, because New York State's looking at this right now.
Mm-hmm.
Is it useful, or does it turn into kind of a nonsense exercise, which I think, the federal IT dashboard might have when it went public, or maybe not. I don't know.
Yeah. Okay. Does someone want to comment on that, or does anyone have an opinion as to whether dashboards are good or bad, or Deborah?
I'll, I think, you know, dashboards as a concept are good. I will tell you that I would be very cynical, however. It's like anytime I look at research and people say, these are our findings, I'm always very cynical as to really the underlying assumptions, the, you know, how they define things. And so I think it's good as a surface level, but unless there's some level of assurance that they ask the right questions, they're counting the right things, and they're counting the right things accurately, so that 98% of the federal agencies are not bumping up as like doing the best in IT. That makes you question, it's like, really? I don't think so. Oops. Jeez. You know, you just might question the validity of the data.
Which is what you're supposed to do, right? You're supposed to ask key performance questions, because otherwise, this collect, process, transform, report stuff, let me put it this way. I think, personal opinion, that if your KPI, if your metrics are over 18 months old, you might be measuring the wrong stuff. Right? Yes?
I just wanted to make a comment on the IT dashboard, and I certainly plan to look more into it, so I don't know enough about it yet, but what I do know, or what I've heard, is that there were a number of projects, because it was designed to sort of see, based on where money was being allocated, where resources were being allocated, and some of these were $30, $40, $50 million IT projects, and so a couple of projects actually got killed partly as a result of the IT dashboard, because they started jumping out in comparison to the other projects, and because of the metrics, getting flagged yellow or red, that something was going terribly wrong and not meeting the metrics. And so I don't know for a fact, but I'm pretty sure a couple of projects that were multi-million-dollar projects got
pulled the plug on. There's like 4 to 6.
And that can tip either way, because the feds have very much focused on the performance tracking of federal grants, federal funding. And in some cases, it's supposedly to be used to determine the budget and the allocations. And in some cases, those that are not doing well are the ones that continue to get funding on the assumption that they need more funding to do a better job. And the other ones that are doing well might not get that, are ones that get cut.
That's
as well. So it can work.
But I think the metrics applied to all IT projects. So it sort of standardized that. And if you weren't meeting certain performance measures, either something had to be changed or the project needed to be killed because it was wasting tens of millions of taxpayer dollars.
Right. So to answer both of those questions, what the federal IT dashboard did is it drew a line and it looked at certain projects and it found several that had much too high a risk factor. No ROI. They really went into the value of that project, and the ROI to these projects became unreasonable. Not worth it. What I don't know whether that dashboard is done, right, is whether they've made a decision to stop these four projects, but did they then go and reset the target and say, now we want to look at these projects that fall into this area. Well, these ones are dead already, right? But do these others that were below the initial radar screen, do we need to look at those? Unless you keep tightening the way you track variation, you're just going to be reporting the same thing over and over again.
Well, on the federal IT dashboard, I mean, the embedded question, I think, is can you be allowed to fail publicly? You know, can a president or a governor or a mayor or an executive let red dots appear?
Yeah.
Or even yellow dots? Because if they can't, then any public-facing public performance measure reporting becomes a joke. And I know that the federal IT dashboard right now is being actively looked at by lots of city and state governments as something to emulate for lots of different things. And so that model is quite important.
It is. And the way I think about that is transparency should lead to accountability. That accountability needs to have consequences, right? The more I've thought about this, the more I disagree with full transparency, right? Because it's the same reason that often private companies do better than publicly traded companies. Because the private companies don't have to perform on a quarterly basis so that Wall Street analysts can make some thumbs up, thumbs down judgment. Private companies get to put in a new phone system that's going to dramatically diminish profits for a year because they know that the long-term return will be there. If we were a fully transparent government, if we were reporting everything, we wouldn't have that. And what we'd have is this conversation about, are we measuring the right things? I think that what we need to do is kind of bring that conversation back to the, what are the few metrics that are going to talk about the results that your agency, in its mission statement, in its vision, has committed to giving to the public, right? And then let the executives figure out what are those few key numbers that they want to use to tell the story they want to tell. Yes, 4 to 10% of the time, people will choose to tell the wrong story, right? And we've got an open media society that will probably catch that sooner or later. But the 90% to 96% of the people are going to tell the right story. They're going to tell the story about child welfare, about improvements in education, about safety of our roads and bridges. So what, you know, it comes down to each agency, and I think the answer is very simple. Start with why. Right? If you're the Department of Transportation, tell me how the transportation infrastructure is. Let's put up some KPIs about that. Now, when I say KPI, does everybody know I need key performance indicator? I'm gonna take a 2 minutes to tell you a quick story here, okay? because a lot of people don't pick the right measures, okay? And I think picking the right measures is very important. And I went in to help a friend who has a manufacturing plant around here, and he walked me through his plant, right? And his plant had these numbers by the machines, 52, 68. And I knew that he needed help with his manufacturing process. And he said that that was actually fine, but he needed help with his sales process. I'm like, really? Because out there in that manufacturing floor, he just had these numbers. Like, he had this number, right? Well, let's shift gears. Let's out of the manufacturing process. This is an indicator, right? But what does it indicate? You know, there's no context to it. You know, now it's a unit of measure, right? 32 means thermometer. But if this is our goal, right, that we want to get to that, or it could be our current state. Let's say our current state is 54, right? Present or baseline, right? And our goal is 32. We know we're here at 54 degrees, and we want to get to 32 degrees, where we want to make ice so we can have a cocktail, right? So we need to now change something in our environment so that this number comes closer to this number. If you're talking about key performance indicators, if you're talking about a scorecard, and all you've got is one number, you know, it says last month there were 32 children dropped out. There were 42 robberies. There were, you know, that number without some sort of time, without some sort of trending over time, really doesn't inform very much, right? So back to the IT scorecard. How is that number changing over time, right? And if they set it so that all of a sudden 94% of the projects are green, what's going on there? Right? It may mean we need to reset our standard, our goal. Because what performance management really does, I'm almost done here, is it allows you to put in place a plan over time. Right? Let's say this is going to be 8 hours to get to lower the temperature of this room type thing. But then you can actually measure your actual progress over time so that you can go and realize where you are and what's going on. If you don't have these four elements, your baseline where you're starting from, your goal where you're trying to get to, and a lot of agencies that I've met don't have this, then you can never really have a plan which is going to allow you to do this. And this is the key part. If you remember nothing else about this, because I've covered so much, frequent dialogue about relevant results. Okay? If you only talk about this performance at the end of an 8-hour shift, if you only get a performance review from your supervisor once a year, you're not going to have enough frequency. You're not going to have enough data to improve your individual performance. If you get it quarterly, that's great. You've got 4 times as much data. If you sit down with your boss monthly and say, how am I doing? Right? If you sat down with your boss for 30 minutes once a week, let's take out some vacation time, you'd have 48 opportunities to improve your performance. You'd have 48 discrete opportunities to say, am I on track to the plan that we put in place originally for my performance? Now, I'm talking about this in an individual sense, right? You and your supervisor, but you're doing the same thing to the administration. You're doing the same thing to the Department of Budget. You're reporting on the same sort of thing. And if you report those numbers annually, my premise is that's not frequent enough to give you the data you need to improve performance. Right? That's the difference between performance measurement, collecting all that stuff, but not putting it into practice, not using it to make better decisions, and actually getting in there and owning it from an individual point of view. I know a lot of people that hear performance management and say, it's just closed. I will let them know what happens at this point, and I will let them know what happens at this point. But that stuff in the middle, there's no way I'm going to share that stuff. And my answer to them is, you know what? If between your point A and your point B, you're meeting your numbers, you're delivering the results you committed to, fine. You know what that's called? Did anybody go to that, where did they talk about results-only work? Anybody heard of this results-only work environment, ROWE?
Yeah, that was the CIO Academy.
So Best Buy did this. Best Buy said, you know what? There's no more vacation days. There's no more sick days. Right? I'm going to give you a number. You're going to have to create a certain number of end caps in the Best Buys across the United States. And if you get that done in 20 weeks, you can take 30 weeks off. Now, mind you, if I'm the manager and I give you a project like that that allows you to take, you know, three-fifths of your time off, I will get fired because I haven't set the right numbers. But my job is to work with each individual to set a goal for them that's within their achievement goal. It's a little bit of a stretch, but that if they do the work, if they get constant, frequent feedback on their performance and they get it done, I'm not going to track their vacation time. If they want to work from midnight to 5 a.m. to get this job done, I don't care. I don't need them in the office. I need the results of their work. All right? So when we talk about frequent feedback, about relevant results, listen carefully. I'm not saying frequent feedback about effort. Because too often performance conversations come to, I've been working really hard. And you know what? If I could have a little bit more time and a few more people on the team, I know I can get that done. Right? That's an effort-based conversation. Right? It's not a results-based conversation. When you get the focus on the results, now you can say, we tried X, we tried Y, we tried Z. We're not going to be able to get it done in that time frame unless we put in your new proposed solution here. Right? Too often people show up and say, you know, I tried X and Y, it's just not going to work. Or, I've got a problem, boss, what do you think I should do? There's no data in that conversation. But if you go to your supervisor and you say, hey, I've got some data that shows you what we've tried to do to solve this problem, can you look at it with me? And see if you can come up, we'll see if we can brainstorm some other alternatives. That's a different conversation. Right? You're focused on the results, not the effort. So, yes?
You're making some good points without explicitly stating them that I've run into through personal experience. And ironically, normally I like to bring in business examples to the government and not-for-profit sector. But in this case, I worked with a number of UN agencies and also governmental agencies that were using some performance indicators and were sticking to it. And they worked because there was incentive.
Mm-hmm.
Just wanted to talk a little about incentive. It was in their job description and, in fact, wouldn't get their sort of final paycheck or their final piece of the grant unless they were completing these performance indicators.
Yep.
And so those worked. And ironically, I worked at a corporation at one point doing project management, and the CEO had a great idea to do a balanced scorecard.
Right.
And they spent a significant amount of everybody's time some people didn't even understand what it was, coming up with all these metrics. And by the end of the first quarter, nobody ever had incentive to track those metrics. They thought it was too time-consuming, and they'd much rather be doing the job that would get those results, and so therefore never tracked it. And so for all the time they invested initially coming up with the metrics, the whole scorecard completely fell apart because there was no incentive for anybody to actually spend the time, because it takes time to actually input the metrics and review that with your management, and for management to review it in strategy meetings. And those are all things that have to be accounted for, because people think they're too busy doing the things that they're measuring to actually measure it.
Right, thank you. Because really what we're talking about is that good performance management is at the intersection of statistics and behavior. Right? And if the balanced scorecard is only focused on those results that are going to be meaningful to a shareholder, right, or the people in the C-level suite but can't cascade down to the individual contributors, they're not relevant.
Well, they actually acknowledged that and came up with ones that were relevant on all levels of the company, but nobody was ever required to actually fill them out after they had
transparency, accountability, consequences. So the behavioral sciences piece here is, have you changed your management force? Have you changed the individual contributors to use this data to identify where the friction is in their system? And then have you trained the managers to be able to say, when I ask you how long this will take, and they say 10 days, the manager should be able to say, can you get it done in 8? Right? They should be able to negotiate what that goal is going to be, how long it's going to take, the volume, the velocity piece. And they're not trained how to. They're all trained to say, 10 days, take 12. Right? And then all of a sudden on the 12th day, they find out that, which is my next illustration here, on the 12th day or too late in the process, they find out that they're only 60% of the way complete. Right? They didn't check in frequently enough to see that it was off track. They waited until way over here to find out that the actual results to this KPI on the balanced scorecard, way off track. Right? So now we're actually after the deadline, and we didn't accomplish the results we committed to, because behaviorally, the organization wasn't used to doing that. Right? Or we've all been trained to get our report cards on a trimester or a quarterly basis. We've all been trained to have an annual performance review, right? It's not frequent enough. If we want to bring performance management into the organization, we need to do it at the one-on-one level, and then we need to make sure that the numbers that we're talking about are cascade or scalable up and down and across the organization.
Yeah, and I'll tell you something kind of ironic at this old job that I had is we had a quarterly review, and and it was rated 1 through 4, and it was never really clear how it was measured. It was a little, very subjective, but except for a few key things like getting projects done on time, but and I filled all of those, but I had also produced a report based on metrics that was based on what we had done earlier in the year on the scorecard, and showed how we could have saved or could save like $100,000 or $200,000. And I actually lost a point on my performance review because they thought I wasn't doing my job because I spent time doing that. So there was no flexibility or encouragement to look for efficiencies in your workflow, but rather you should just be doing your job. Right. So there was definitely no incentive. In fact, it was a disincentive.
A disincentive, right. Because even though you've
spoken
about it.
Does that affect your bonus in the corporate world? I'm not sure how that works on an agency side. I guess it affects your ability to move up or get a promotion.
Yeah, but there's not a lot of that going on right now. I tell you, the thing that I have found that is most effective at engaging managers, directors, and individual contributors is to go to the individual and collect data about performance, about things that frustrate them. Right? Nobody wants to come to work and have their job suck.
But people are afraid to speak up.
They used to be. Because when they did it, they were being transparent about the fact that they're being held accountable for doing 8, but they can only get 6 done in the time period, in the week. And they know that the reason they can only get six done is because they've got to key the data in three or four times, or because the app crashes every Wednesday at 2 o'clock when the backup server kicks on. Right? They know it, but they're afraid to tell their boss that they lost 4 units of work because they keep forgetting that at Wednesday at 2 o'clock they need to save 1:59 they need to save their data. Right? But in a performance environment, in a performance culture, the individuals are able to go to their boss and say, geez, you know, what can we do about this Wednesday at 2 o'clock thing? Because I'm losing work. Well, geez, doesn't have to. We could. I think it's supposed to be 2 o'clock a.m., and it's just a wrong toggle in the a.m. p.m. switch is causing this crash. Fix that, and all of a sudden the numbers start to go up. We haven't trained behavioral sciences individuals to be able to say, this is what prevents me from doing my best work. Because people want to do their best work. They do. And things get in the way, and you can use this performance management philosophy to help them identify and talk about it. Question?
Yeah, I do. How do you, and within the rubric of performance management or that frame, which is often translated into time and cost for in government, how do you justify people going to stuff like Capital Camp that can have enormous cultural value and, you know, spur all kinds of innovative thinking and really great insights into doing things much, much better? And I would say this goes to the whole open government movement, which is often, what is the return on investment open government, which there are conferences on. And everyone says, we don't know. But we know that places that do open government stuff and talk about it and have inculcated in that in their culture tend to be pretty high performing.
Yeah.
And so within performance measurement, which usually, you know, one of the metrics is money.
Yep.
How do you talk about these things?
So the way I look at that is I often say that organizations from the East India Trading Company up until today have been put in place to protect a status quo, which for the larger world means making a lot of money, right? That's the 1%, the Wall Street piece. But government organizations are also put in place to protect the status quo. Right? And there's a lot of things about that. I think one of the things that needs to happen is you need to establish a sense of urgency around the fact that maybe the status quo isn't working as well as it used to. Right? So I look at an organization like this, and I kind of say that there are some A players here, and there are some B players, and there are some C players. I'm not going down the Jack Welch road, but I'm saying to justify events like this, you need to motivate these high-performing people with opportunities to go out and engage in ideas. And you can make them responsible for bringing that information back for a simple 8-paragraph summary email or a presentation that they're going to give at the next staff meeting to start inculcating ideas. Here's the way I look at it. Farmers don't grow crops. Farmers create environments within which crops can grow, right? Soil, fertilizer, keep some of the rain away, right? Make it till, keep the weeds away. You need to find out who are those change agents, those overly curious people in your agency, right, or your group, and how do you inspire them to come back and create an environment within which change, within which conversations about performance can become more real, more tangible, more effective, more impactful on the organization. Right? Who are the people that are going to start driving frequent dialogue about relevant results? Who are the people that are going to identify what's relevant? What are the results we're going to focus on? Who are going to put in place the meetings that create that frequency? Deborah, I saw your hand.
I want to go back to a comment that John made because I think it's going to be a crux of open government, transparency, open data in the public sector, and that is, do you have the latitude to fail? Because that is a key point. We are a very reactionary environment. We flip politically, you know, 4 years, oh, they've done a bad job, go to the next one. Mm-hmm. And once data is out there, and I'm not talking about just IT, you know, projects, it's using IT at all kinds of services across the board, and if suddenly there is a lot of something going maybe amiss, people see that data online, and suddenly you've got a law named after somebody so that you're not going to do that again.
Right.
As opposed to saying, we are collecting the wrong data in the first place, perhaps. Mm-hmm. And there's got to, and I don't know where that kind of permission comes from to say, it's like a testing ground to work it out, see what works, what's not, and not take an immediate reactionary response to say, oh, wipe it clean because you did it wrong.
Right.
The data shows
right.
it.
Yeah. And the state is not a safe environment to experiment in. And yet, it is those prototypes, it is those pilot projects that really need to be allowed to fail. Right? But we can't fail on the big project. Right, but we can implement that big project and then at the same time be piloting some sort of measure, some sort of scorecard that's delivered to a mobile device or something, right? So that we can get those things. It's a real challenge, you know, because especially this is why I'm really rethinking about what do we mean when we define the word transparency? Because if you're fully transparent, you don't have any of that latitude to make a mistake. And that's just not realistic. Right, so it's a big part of what needs to be addressed with when you put that plan in place to get from point A to point B, you need to factor in that there are going to be mistakes made along the way. And if you're looking at the data around the performance more frequently, you know, I guess my answer would be fail faster, right? Or put in place the early radar system so that you can say, wait a minute, the pattern that I'm seeing says that this isn't going to make it over the goal line. So kill that project faster. Don't wait until the IT dashboard, you know, plasters you up there. You become one out of six out of 180 projects that gets killed. You know, let's empower people to be able to stand up earlier and say, wait a minute, this isn't going to work. The emperor has no clothes. This project is just never going to get back on track. Let's start over. You know, let's take our lumps and learn our lessons. I don't know how to do that because, again, you're back to the behavioral sciences piece, which is I am not sharing these cards with you. Not ever. Mm-hmm. Right? We need to start making it freer for people to put two or three of these things forward. Right? Or we're never going to be able to start talking about performance at a one-on-one level, right, with our stakeholders, the citizens, or within our agencies.
I'm not quite understanding when you say that you're not sure you're for full transparency because you're not allowed to fail. And one of the examples you gave was that privately owned companies have the ability to spend a lot of money and mm-hmm. take a loss for that year.
Right.
Whereas the public ones have to worry about what the shareholders
are
going
to do. Yeah.
Isn't part of that full transparency the fact that you expected to take a loss and that you're actually on track for that loss, not more than you expected? Because if you say,
sure.
I'm going to implement this phone thing and it's going to cost $1 billion this year,
right.
but we expect to make that back in 10 years, I think if I was a public owner of that company and they set, and they stuck to that $1 billion and they didn't go to $2 or $3 billion,
mm-hmm.
I would say, okay, I'm for that because I'm going to see a return on my my investment.
But I would just say some of the problem with that level of transparency is you don't always have the most sophisticated people making the decisions at that point, and they can still vote with their feet, their votes, their money. So whether it's a public company and you have somebody who's not sophisticated who was reactionary, or it's constituents who vote based on a, not an understanding or a grasp or an agreement. Just they may just say $1 million is too expensive. So
and that should be their
conversation.
Right, I mean, as a constituent, I should have the right to know where that money's going and
right.
know whether I agree that I really do think it's going to make $10 billion over the
yeah.
long run. If I disagree with that fact, I should have the right to say, I don't agree with this project.
Yeah.
But you won't have a chance to have the results.
Right.
So,
yeah.
I mean,
so, a little bit
less transparency where it can be more results-based.
Right. There's two levels here. One is that there's a certain level of conversation that we're comfortable having at the program management office level. Can you justify that project to us internally so that we would invest in that? Right? Can you meet these criteria so that we would invest in that? The other is, what is the data that you want to share with the public to tell the story about how you're accomplishing the mission of your agency? They don't have to be the same thing. So again, it's what do you want the different constituent groups to pay attention to? So that frequent dialogue about relevant results is modified to each group.
I just add one more thing.
Yep.
Like a lot of transparency, for one of the I would say, results of transparency initiatives that we probably haven't observed yet, but if enough people take advantage of it, we will, is that the public, and specifically the media, when empowered with all this information, they'll realize that it is common for government to fail sometimes.
Right.
And it's not like this gotcha moment where, hey, we uncovered, you know, $1 million of overspending, let's write about it, and then it's a big deal, and everyone, you know, everyone gets really excited, and it's a media circus around mm-hmm. that issue. But if we all just know, okay, some projects fail, some are successful, you get to see it all, the public will have those tools to make good decisions and to get excited and about our government successes along with its failures.
Hey, I'm sorry, this is an awesome session, but we got to move on.
That's fine. That's fine.
This is absolutely fabulous.
For sure. Thank you.
Very interactive. It didn't go away.